Now let's take a 3D tour of the cochlea, and here I haven't shown the complete cochlea. It is just about 1.5 tons that are shown because my computer crashed several times when I tried to make the complete 3D model of the cochlea. So it is slightly lighter model and it is not 100% anatomically correct, but it will help you understand the anatomy and histology of the cochlea to a great extent. And of course it is colorized and more of a schematic 3D diagram, but it will help you understand the concept. So now let's dive into the cochlea, and we are going into the cochlear duct or scala media. If we take the walls into consideration, then it is cochlear duct, but if we talk about the lumen, then it is scala media. And here you can see that supporting cells are there, and they are lying on the top of basilar membrane, which is forming the floor of cochlear duct. And then we have these inner hair cells and we have these outer hair cells. And here we have the tectorial membrane, and here we have the Reisner's membrane, which is forming the roof of this cochlear duct. And here we have the stria vascularis. Please note that all these structures, they run along the long axis of cochlea. So that is why this organ of corti, it is also spiral structure. It is a continuous spiral structure, just like the cochlea, which is spiral. Really arrange this organ of corti, because it is along the long axis of cochlea. It runs along the long axis of cochlea, and that is why it is also the spiral organ, just like the cochlea. In books and previously in this lecture, you had just seen a small section of this organ of corti. So some people might assume that, okay, this is just the section of the organ of corti, and it is just the section that is actually organ of corti, but this is wrong. Don't assume it. It is a long continuous spiral organ. And now we are going into the cochlear duct, and we are seeing this organ of corti. I have made the tectorial membrane slightly translucent so you can see what is below it. And okay, so we are traversing through this, and let's see what happens. Let's move slightly lateral. Please note that tectorial membrane does not reach till the lateral wall of the cochlear duct. It is not touching the lateral wall of the cochlear duct. So we are traversing and traversing, and ultimately what will happen? Let's see. So ultimately this will be closed at the end, at the apex of the cochlea it will be closed. But somehow if we traverse through the wall, we are not ghost, but still somehow with the help of CGI we can traverse through the wall. So here we have traversed through the wall. So here there will be another place which is basically called helicotrema. Now this helicotrema, you can see what happens here, that at the top here we have let me show you, at the top we have, what is this, we have scala vestibuli, and then here we have the ending of scala media, and below it we have scala tympani. So we can come out through the scala tympani. So this is the scala tympani. Basically what happens, that the sound waves, the very low frequency sound waves, they can pass through the scala vestibuli, and they can, through the helicotrema, they can go to the scala tympani, and they can come out of the scala tympani like this. So here we are coming out of the scala tympani. We went through the scala media and we are coming out of the scala tympani, which is not actually possible because there is a wall at the end. But if we had went through the scala vestibuli, then we could have came out through the scala tympani. So this is the cochlea. So let's suppose we go through the scala vestibuli now, then we can easily come out from the scala tympani. Let's see, we are going out through the scala vestibuli, which is a top layer. Let's move slightly laterally. Oh, sorry. So here we are. Now here is the helicotrema, and then there is that ending of scala vestibuli, not vestibuli, sorry, scala media, and then here we can come out through the scala tympani. So now we are in the scala tympani, and we are coming out of scala tympani like this. That is how the very low frequency sound travels. This is very low frequency sound that might not even be detected by our ear. So this is it. Let me tell you more about the helicotrema. If we remove a part of it, if we cut it from here, and we will see this is the situation, that this is the scala vestibuli, this is the scala tympani. So very low frequency sound from the scala vestibuli can go directly into scala tympani like this through this helicotrema. This will become slightly more clear in the next 3D model. So this was about the 3D tour of cochlea. Now let's move forward. If you want to understand the embryology and basic histology of the ear of the cochlea, then lecture up till now is enough. But we will slightly dive into the physiology of ear, and to understand the physiology, we are assuming a more simplified picture of the cochlea and specifically of the organ of corti. So here we have the Reisner's membrane, the basilar membrane, but we are assuming that supporting cells are not there. Well, actually they are there, and they are very important functionally, but here, just to understand how the sense of hearing works, we are just showing the inner hair cells to make the things simpler and easier to understand. And we are looking at the row of inner hair cells, and along with that we have the tectorial membrane, and again they are also spirally arranged. I think I do not need to go into details, because you already know these things, that these are also spirally arranged. So I hope you can understand this thing. Now what we will do is that, to make it more simpler and easier to understand, we will uncoil the cochlea like this. So let's suppose the cochlea is uncoiled, and here we have this helicotrema. So here you can see, here we have the helicotrema, and the sound waves can cross from the scala vestibuli to the scala tympani. So here is an uncoiled cochlea. Now the problem is that from outside it is surrounded by the aortic capsule, the bony aortic capsule, which is full of bone. So from where the sound enters into this? Well, actually from bone the sound can enter, but it is not that much efficient, because it is relatively a thick bone, petrous part of temporal bone. So what happens here, that a small opening develops, and it is not actually opening, it is actually covered with a membrane, a thin membrane. So here you can see an oval opening appears within the vestibule, and it is covered with a thin membrane. Here you can see. Now the sound waves can enter through this opening, through this membrane, the oval window. This is called oval window. The sound waves can enter through this oval window, and sound waves can then cause the vibration of these membranes. Basically the sound waves can easily traverse through the vestibular membrane or Reisner's membrane, but they do not cross the basilar membrane. They cause vibration of the basilar membrane that we will see later. But the point is that sound waves enter the ear through this oval window, mainly through this oval window. Of course, they can also enter somewhat through the bone, but mainly through this oval window. Now another point that is worth discussing here is that this bony labyrinth, which is filled with perilymph, and perilymph is incompressible, just like any other fluid. You know, fluid is almost incompressible, and so that is why, as the sound waves enter here, as the oval window vibrate, this vibration must somehow, there must be some bulging out at somewhere else, because the fluid is incompressible. Let me explain it briefly for you. So for example, let's suppose here is a closed tube. Right, so this tube is covered. From here also there is a membrane, and here also there is a membrane. So what will happen that, for example, if the sound wave, let's suppose, pushes here, it causes pushing like this here, it pushes it here due to vibration, it vibrates first inward and then outward, so there is continuous vibration actually. So as there is bulging in this membrane, another part, let's suppose the other part is here, this membrane should bulge out. So if it goes in, this should come out. So there is this part, this oval window, which can bulge in, but from where it should bulge out, from where this, I should say, how the sound wave now dissipates. So to dissipate the sound wave, another window develops, and that window is somewhat round, and that is called round window. But where should this round window develop? Should this round window develop here? Let's suppose we form the round window here. So now what will happen? Now the point is that the sound waves within the fluid, they follow the shortest and easier path, right? And the shortest and easier path will be that sound wave would travel from here like this and would dissipate here. So if this happens, the sound wave will not go into the cochlea. So we want the sound wave to enter into the cochlea. So what is the solution for this? The solution is that the round window should develop somewhat here. So if the round window develops here, somewhat here, for example, then what will happen? The sound waves enter through this common vestibule, and then they will go through this like this, and they can somewhat stimulate here or here, whatever, wherever they can. And if they cannot, if they fail to stimulate anywhere this membrane, this basilar membrane, if they fail to stimulate it anywhere, then the sound wave can come out through the helicotrema, and they can reach somewhat here in the round window. So I hope you understand that why the round window is exactly here. Why not here? Why not here? This is a very important thing to understand. I hope you are very clear. If you are still unclear about this, please do comment and I will try to explain it even more clearly. So now here is the round window. You see, the oval window is within the common vestibule. So theoretically, you must be thinking that sound wave should go into anywhere. Sound wave should travel into semicircular canal, into this saccule, vestibule, wherever. It can go anywhere, but the sound wave rarely go anywhere else, because the shortest and easier path is through this cochlea, the round window. Because the round window is here, so they can travel like this. Right, so this is important to understand. Now this basilar membrane is shaped like this, that its basal parts, it can sense high frequency vibration, high frequency sound waves, and the apical part, it can sense the low frequency, very low frequency sound waves. So normally, if the frequency is very low, it should travel like this. Let me show you exactly. So it should travel like this. It should go here and it should travel like this through the helicotrema, and it should come out like this, right? From here it should come out. But what happens that if the frequency is very high, frequency of sound is very high, the sound wave cause vibration somewhat here, and this vibration then travels through here and it comes out here. So it takes a further shortcut, right? It takes another shortcut here, and if it is further lower, then if the frequency become lower, for example, it might stimulate here, or if it is further lower here and here and here and so on. In this way, this is the basis of frequency discrimination. I'm not gonna go into details, but let's go into another 3D model to understand it slightly even better. So let's suppose this is the basalmost part of the cochlea and this is the apical part. So what happens that a high frequency sound will stimulate, it will cause the vibration of the basilar membrane at the basal part, and low frequency sound will stimulate the apical part. So as the wave is traveling, as it finds that, okay, here I can vibrate, so it takes the shortest path from here. Here will be the round window. Here is the somewhat here would be the vestibule, the oval window, and somewhat here will be the round window. So for example, if the sound is very high pitched, it will stimulate it here. So if the sound is high pitched, so let's see how the sound travels. That I'm just gonna demonstrate it. So here very low frequency, but here very high frequency sound, and here very low, high frequency, and here is very low frequency, low pitch, like that thick sound here, and here very thin sound. So imagine if a beautiful woman speaks in her beautiful high pitched sound, it will stimulate the base of your cochlea, or even maybe the base of your heart. The base of the cochlea closer to sexy saccule will be stimulated by a high pitched sound of a beautiful woman. But imagine if an old man is speaking, then even your cochlea will ignore, and it will say the sound should go to the apex, not to the base. It will just take the longer path. And that's how this system of hearing works. Thank you so much for watching this video.